This is a look today. This is, I haven't brushed my hair in 3 days. Well, you know, it's actually not that bad. Hello, my dears. My name is Mariana and welcome to my channel. I have a really quick announcement. Actually, I have two announcements. The first one is that for the month of November, my archetypal tarot meditation kit is only $26 because November has been crazy. 2020 has been crazy and we need to meditate. And if you're a tarot lover like I am, there's literally nothing better. The second announcement I have, and the one I'm really, really excited about, is I am launching my first ever Persephone Sister seminar called Archetypal Tarot 101. So in this seminar, you can broaden your approach to the tarot through an archetypal, mythopoetic, and psycho-spiritual lens to deepen and enrich your reading experience. This is for beginners and pros alike. And most excitingly, it's sliding scale pricing. So wherever you can afford it, there's an option for you. And I hope I see you there. So I get asked a lot about reading materials and other resources to deepen people's tarot practice. And so I thought I'll put together a video about all the stuff that I've personally engaged with to deepen my own practice, and hopefully that'll be useful in yours. We're going to go through 5 fields of study that will really enhance your understanding of the tarot and kind of broaden it so you have not just a understanding of what the cards mean, but an understanding of what the archetypes of the tarot mean, of how to work with it as an occult, divinatory, and psychological practice. And for each of these fields of study, I'm going to offer some recommended reading. I'll definitely leave all those resources in the description, so definitely check that out. And let's get started. So the first field of study I think you really need to dive into as a tarot practitioner, whether you're a newbie or a professional, is occultism. And I think a lot of people have this assumption that tarot is in and of itself an occult practice. And while that may be true today, the origins of the tarot actually derive from religious practice and even from just a playing card game. So it wasn't used for divinatory practices. It wasn't an occult item back then. But at that time period, magic was absolutely real. People followed really specific formulas to divine the future or to enhance their magical practices. At the time, people really believed that matter and spirit could work together. Things that occultists really focused on at the time were planetary placements and bodily humors and the correspondences between matter and spirit. And so it's really cool to kind of look at the way that magic was understood at the time that the tarot came to be to sort of reignite your own magical work. I personally, and a lot of people, don't actually use the tarot for divination. It's not used to predict the future. But we do, in a low-key kind of way, use it as a divinatory tool that can probe the depths that we can't see, or even glimpse into the possibilities of what may come. So I think really examining the occult, examining how the idea of magic interacted with the spirit inside of us and the spirit outside of us, and then the conduit being the material world, the actual cards we pick up and the actual magic we perform, I think that's a really beneficial field of study for anybody trying to deepen their understanding and connection to the tarot. So the two books I recommend to study occultism is A History of Magic, Witchcraft, and the Occult. I haven't read it myself, but this seems a really cool kind of dive into the history of occultism and gives like a sort of overview of the different practices. And the deeper dive is The 3 Books of Occult Philosophy of Magic by Henry Cornelius Agrippa. And those books are very cool and very dense, and you might not necessarily wanna go through the whole thing. I didn't honestly myself, but that has so much good occult material, so definitely check that one out. The second field of study is alchemy and mysticism. And I lumped these two together because when you look at them in the historical moment that they were most practiced, they really can't be separated out from each other. Both alchemy and mysticism found their height in like the 14th through 18th centuries. Alchemy obviously has really ancient roots, and mysticism does as well. But when they merged in the early modern period, we had this really beautiful explosion of spiritual awakening. This is when the tarot came to be as well, and I don't at all think that that's accidental. So people think of alchemy being a practice of like bonding materials, looking for the sorcerer's stone or trying to make lead into gold. And while these were like superficial practices of alchemists, the real alchemical work was very deep and profound and extremely spiritual. The idea behind alchemy was the merging of matter and soul. It was literally looking at how you can manipulate the physical world into creating God stuff. Oftentimes, the goal of alchemy was the panacea, which means the all-healing element. And looking back on it with a modern perspective, we can see this as like a psychological phenomenon of looking for the all-healing within ourselves, the path to wholeness. And a lot of the alchemists at the time were also mystics. They really were willing to engage with ideas that came from Christianity and Islam and Judaism that were kind of fringe ideas, these mystical ideas, and mold them into this really beautiful way of thinking. There's a lot of things we see in alchemical texts that derive directly from mystical thinking, like the alchemical Sophia, the goddess of knowledge and wisdom, who comes directly from Judaic mysticism of the first century. Alchemy and mysticism are so essential for really deepening your understanding of the tarot, because the tarot we work with today is derived from the work of Aleister Crowley and Arthur Waite, who were two men who came from these like hermetic alchemical traditions. They took this ancient knowledge, which many had kind of ignored or forgotten or allowed to just be sitting on the fringe of society, and they adapted it into the tarot and realized that this was this beautiful integration of these ancient and modern ideas that were symbols for how we can live, how we can become whole beings. So a lot of the symbolism of the tarot is derived from these alchemical and mystical images. So there are so many books to read. So definitely check out Alchemy and Mysticism. And this one is by Tashen, I think that's how you pronounce it. And it is a collection of imagery, so you really don't need a deep dive too much, but you can really take a look at all the beautiful things, the correspondences, and look at how they were interpreted back then, and you know, compare that to the way you work with the tarot now. There's also a really good Jungian book on alchemy is Alchemy, An Introduction to the Symbolism and the Psychology by Marie-Louise von Franz. And this is a really heavy duty, really rewarding book. The third field of study you should really look into is mythology. This might seem really obvious in some ways, but I think it's really greatly overlooked. There's really clear ways that mythology and tarot overlap. You have the fool, who's like the mythological hero, and you have the strength card, which is like meeting the lion. These are tropes we see in mythology all the time. But I think when you go and read the myths themselves, when you educate yourself on what mythological trends you can find and connect to the tarot, it becomes so much deeper and so much more profound. I think the most interesting way of looking at this is through the lens of Joseph Campbell's monomyth. And the idea is that there is sort of a singular journey through which all heroes, all mythological heroes pass on their way toward individuation, on their way toward wholeness. And when you actually take a look at the tarot and the arc of the tarot, you can see this journey playing out in the cards. You can see the fool as the hero herself really winding through the journey. And so I deeply recommend actually reading the myths. Read about Persephone, read about Inanna, read about Perseus and Gilgamesh. Witness how these tarot archetypes have actually played out in our collective unconsciousness, our connection through imagery and symbolism. So I have, again, a lot of recommendations. The first one is get a good book on mythology. Just get like a world mythology book and peruse it. You don't have to sit down and read it all at once. And I totally recommend The Hero with a Thousand Faces by Joseph Campbell. It is so deep and so profound. I think it's not too inaccessible of a read, and it honestly is kind of life-changing as a tarot reader. So I definitely think you should check that one out. And if you haven't read 78 Degrees of Wisdom by Rachel Pollack, really go read that one. I know that's like on the top 10 list of like all tarot books you must read, but it's true. Rachel Pollack does such a good job of integrating so many of these different fields of study and analyzing the tarot through those lenses. And she does a particularly good job keeping mythological material in mind as she, you know, dives into the meanings of the cards. So that's a great one. And so the last field of study that you absolutely must dive into at least a little bit, in my opinion, is depth psychology. So personally, this has been the most fruitful field of study for my practice. I think as a professional tarot reader, you really have to have some kind of base understanding about psychology. Maybe that comes from your own practice, you know, having a therapist in your life that you can work with and understanding how that relationship is built. Or maybe it's studying it through books, taking a class. I personally have done most of my psychological study on my own through reading materials. I think that if you're working with people in an emotional and psychological way, which you can't avoid when you're doing tarot, you really need a foundation on how that should go. Depth psychology is such a vibrant field because it not only accepts the psychological realm of what goes on in our hearts and minds, but then it merges that with our souls and magic itself. The Jungians are really cool to read because they kind of take a little bit of all these fields that we've mentioned. They look at mythology and alchemy and mysticism and occultism, and they're willing to put that all together and look at that in the frame of the psyche, of how we're trying to integrate all the pieces of ourself. So if you really want to understand the tarot, which I believe and many believe is basically the metaphor for the path of individuation, you really need to have a basic understanding of the breadth and wonder of the depth psychological field. And so there are a lot of books that will look at how the tarot is this path of individuation. So my favorite is Jung and Tarot, An Archetypal Journey by Sally Nichols. It's really good. It's really well written. It is not too hard to read. And it's basically looking at a Jungian interpretation of the tarot and how that is our path to individuation. Another fantastic one is Man and His Symbols by Carl Jung, and this is a look at really the core of archetypes and how they play out in the psyche of humankind. Thank you so much for joining me. This was really kind of a fun video for me. I got to dive into the things that I've studied, so thank you for watching and sitting with me as I indulge myself a little bit. Make sure you are subscribed. Make sure that you follow me on Instagram for a little bit of witchery and wisdom for your psycho-spiritual journey. And bonus, if you do support me as a creator on Patreon, then you get super discounts to my seminars, so go check that out. And I would love for you to leave in the comments your own, you know, fields of study that you've worked with the tarot to deepen your understanding of the cards. I'm really fascinated by this, so please tell me that. So thank you so much, my dears, and have a beautiful, meaningful day.